New CNN reporting this morning about an overwhelming sense of frustration among Democrats over what is being described as mismanagement inside the Biden administration. One member of Congress calls the White House rudderless, aimless, and hopeless. Joining us now, CNN senior reporter Edward-Isaac Dovere, who broke this story. Isaac, the call is coming from within the caucus. I mean, these are Democrats telling you these things. What are they saying?
Well, John, that's right. Like, there is a lot of frustration that they want more action out of President Biden. They feel like days, weeks go by, there's not enough going on to say that they're taking decisive moves to combat inflation. Obviously, it's a big problem that is very complicated, but still, they'd like to see some activity around it, and they'd like to see that on other things. They'd like to see more decision-making go on. They'd like to see some accountability when it comes to even firing people over the baby formula situation or other things before that, that have continued to crop up in this administration, in this White House, and they feel like this is feeding a problem that the president has and that Democrats have going into the midterms in November, that there is not enough decisive action going on, that people don't feel like they're responsive enough to all of the problems that are there. And it's also feeding some doubts about where President Biden would be for re-election in 2024.
And this has really reached a fever pitch following the Supreme Court overturning Roe v. Wade. There was a call that Democrats were on. Deborah Messing was on. She's been very active, obviously, in Democratic politics. And this is one of the more colorful moments in this piece of yours. Messing said she'd gotten Joe Biden elected and wanted to know why she was being asked to do anything at all, yelling that there didn't even seem a point to voting. Others wondered why the call was happening. It really speaks to this fatalism that you describe in your article.
Yeah, and that was a call that happened, that Dobbs decision overturning Roe v. Wade was on a Friday. That call was the following Monday, so it was one of the soonest things that happened in the response. But of course, there wasn't a lot of clear action from the White House on what they were doing. They did have this call with a bunch of celebrity and activist supporters. Alyssa Milano was also on the call complaining. But there is this feeling among a lot of Democrats right now that they did what they were supposed to do. They voted for Joe Biden to beat Donald Trump. They voted for Democrats. They're in the House and the Senate. Why isn't more happening? What's even the point? And that is something that Democrats obviously are fighting back against when it comes to midterm voting. They want a lot of turnout in November. But overall, to think that there's still reason to be invested in all of these causes. There's still reason to keep going, because it's not like any of the problems that we're facing as a country and that Joe Biden came in with were easy or fast things to fix.
They want to see, in your reporting, Isaac, the White House and the president fighting. They want to see him angry. They want to see him at least trying, in their words, to do something more, even if it doesn't succeed. You've been doing some reporting along these lines for some months, Isaac. I'm curious, are you finding it easier or harder to find Democrats willing to come forward now? There are a few direct quotes in there. There are a few people who don't mind being quoted on the record now, it seems. And what does the White House say in response?
Well, we're still in a situation where people, especially elected politicians, feel some loyalty to the president that is overriding their desire to get into a fight with them in public. But they also tell me that some of the reason why they don't want to talk publicly or put their names to some of the quotes that are in this article is because they feel like then they just get landed on by the White House as being problem people, but that it doesn't change what actually happens. So they don't want to deal with that. The question that you asked, John, about whether people are more willing to do this, I was actually surprised at how willing, even in an anonymous quoting way, some of the people were willing to go, and just some of the just agitation that is coming out among members of Congress, other elected officials around the country. I talked to a lot of people in Washington for the story, but a lot of people who are not in Washington, in elective office and around elected officials, who just feel like they just want more out of the president. And also, when the president has said things like, Mitch McConnell's a friend of mine, I think we can work with Mitch McConnell, a lot of Democrats say, stop saying that. We don't want to hear that. We want to hear how we're going to beat Mitch McConnell.
Joining us now, former presidential candidate, former DNC chair, the former governor of Vermont, Howard Dean, and CNN political commentator and attorney Bakari Sellers. Friends, this article has a lot going on inside of it. There's one anecdote, Bakari, that on the morning that the Supreme Court came out with the decision to overturn Roe versus Wade, Dana Remus, the White House counsel, was telling everyone inside the White House, according to this article, the decision's not coming today. It's not coming today. So as a result, the article says the White House wasn't ready to react to a decision that basically, because of the Politico leak, people had been known was coming for months. So, Bakari, what do you make of all of this?
Well, first, I mean, when you talk about that anecdote from the article, it's inexcusable. I mean, I said this past Sunday on CNN State of the Union, and people thought I was out of my mind, that Democrats were caught flat-footed. And that's just fundamentally inexcusable when you've had weeks, if not months, to understand. And I mean, Governor Dean can tell you, Republicans have been saying they were going to overturn Roe for 40 years. And so this wasn't something that should have caught us off guard. And the fact is, Congress is still on vacation. The White House has still failed to put forth some concrete action. There are many of us who are supporters, who are friends, who are fans, who want something to do other than vote harder. And I think that is the frustration that many Democrats feel. I do think if you're a United States congressman and you feel that froggy, you should actually put your name on that quote. But I do understand the frustration that many people are feeling that, look, you know, we need something to do, and we need Joe Biden to be present and to be a leader that meets this moment.
Well, to that point, Governor, it seems like the overarching theme here is that Democrats want there to be urgency coming from the White House. They don't really feel like they're getting that from the president, and that includes Democratic leaders who don't feel that they're getting that from the president.
I kind of disagree. Look, Politico is a great gossip magazine for what I think is basically middle school on steroids, which is inside the Beltway. And the truth is, Joe Biden said things about the Supreme Court which needed to be said, which I've never heard a president say. He's basically called them out for being un-American, unpatriotic, and a failure. And way out of step and taking away people's rights. That's an extraordinary thing for a president to say. It happens to be true. This is a Supreme Court that's gone rogue on us. I was delighted to hear Biden say that. So, who knows what this whatever deputy counsel said about when the decision was coming. I think this is mostly inside the Beltway. And it's also frustration, though. We're very frustrated. Here we have a court which has decided to adopt the legislative branch occupation instead of doing what they're supposed to be doing. And the truth is, they're probably in lower repute than the Congress of the United States, and that's hard to do.
Is it all just inside the Beltway? Bakari Sellers, you are a Democratic activist, in South and North Carolina. You're in both places a lot. What are you hearing? Is it just inside the Beltway, or are Democrats genuinely?
No, it's not just inside the Beltway. And I can agree with Governor Dean on the fact that we were very happy and pleased to hear the president's words. But, you know, the scripture teaches us that faith without works is dead, right? And so the question is, what are we going to do? I mean, I hear the verbiage coming from the president, but what is the directive? I mean, you know, when are we going to understand the pressure that has to be placed on Kyrsten Sinema and Joe Manchin so that we can codify privacy rights? When are we actually, and even if we can't do that, why doesn't the United States House of Representatives actually put up a federal abortion ban and vote it down so that we can hang this proverbially around the neck of every Republican that's going to be running in the fall? I mean, do something, I think, is the point that people are saying. There's been no executive action around Roe. There's been no executive action around reproductive rights. And so you're going to be calling on these same people to come out and support you and vote for you in August and September and October as early voting kicks off for November. And the point is, we're not giving folk anything to be excited about, and we don't have that fierce urgency of now.
Governor, what do you think about that?
I think there's some truth to the fact that Biden grew up as an insider. He's spent the majority of his life in Congress, and he plays the inside the Beltway game. But where I agree with, or maybe I'm not sure this is agreement, but what I would respond to Bakari is saying is this: this is not up to people inside Washington. Do not expect people inside Washington to change anything. This is up to us. We have to get out and throw these people out. I want to see Sherry Beasley beat the butt out of this bud in North Carolina. He's an incompetent whack job, and she's 4 points ahead, and she can win. That's a Senate seat that we pick up. We have to take matters into our own hands. We cannot rely on Washington politicians of either party. to get this done. We have to go out and do it ourselves. We should have done what I tried to do when I was chairman of the DNC, and that's take over state legislatures. The fight is in the states and in the legislatures. It's not in Congress. And if we rely on Washington politicians to solve this problem, it's going to get worse. So this is where I agree with Bakari. This is on the ground stuff. And we've got to fight state by state and district by district in the state legislatures to beat this. But I am not up for whacking the president of the United States. He didn't write that thing, that ridiculous nonsense that pretended to be a Supreme Court opinion. And we need Supreme Court reform. We need to pack the court. We need to get these people off. Clarence Thomas ought to be impeached and removed because he's ruling on cases that his wife has a financial interest in. This is a corrupt organization. It needs to be fixed. We can only fix it if we fight and we elect people at the local level who will get rid of these people at the federal level.